And done with sharks. Okay. You know, it's been a while since I've seen something without a shark in it. Video games. Video games sound good. Let's... Huh. I haven't seen that open in a while. Kind of forgot about it. Ooh. That looks cool.
Far Cry. It's the original one too. It's pretty cool. Yeah, this will be worth taking a look at.
Huh? Oh, son of a... I'm Shyboy616, and welcome to my review of Far Cry. So just very quickly before getting into the movie, I wanted to give a breakdown and review of the video game, seeing as it's the source material for this adaptation. Far Cry is a game series I feel like needs little introduction, unless of course you've never played it or haven't really been near these types of games. So in short, Far Cry is a first-person shooter. It's more of an old-school shooter by today's standards, specifically coming out in 2004. This is back when it wasn't commonplace to use the sights of every weapon, unless that had a scope, where when you'd aim down the sights, instead of your character doing this, they would do this. This game, however, was also fairly revolutionary in terms of AI and level design. The enemies in this game are technically smarter than what was seen before. They would actually try to maneuver around the player rather than just having a set position or direction to go. And sometimes it works, sometimes it, well, doesn't. And part of it not working isn't necessarily that they're dumb, but that they're too perfect. Like they would just know exactly where you were, adding on to this game's notorious difficulty. I don't think it was hard necessarily for the right reasons, as they would damage you more and they could just shoot you through about anything, and if one found out where you were, suddenly they all know exactly where you are. This wasn't the case all the time, as some levels I felt were designed better. What made this game's level design fairly unique was how open the environments were. You didn't necessarily have to go a straight path all the time. While there were some linear levels, most of them were fairly open, so you could take just about any route you wanted to, within the means of the map, of course. This more open-ended level design, on top of the enhanced AI, made for a more dynamic experience, forcing you to plan each attack and where you needed to be. Whether that was moving cover to cover, or picking a strategic spot, or the game's on some BS and you kinda just have to pop in and out at one spot hoping you don't get hit in the process. And I changed the difficulty several times, it was the same issue no matter what, so do with that what you will. Another thing I wanted to point out before getting into the story was this game has a fairly stylish armory, as well as a very nice location. The setting of the game is on a chain of Pacific islands. This gives a very colorful and vibrant environment to go through, which is also contrasted by ancient ruins, World War II ruins left by the Japanese, and labs. There's a little variety on top of your very lovely island. There's also some vehicle segments, and I think that added some variety, not necessarily great variety, as they weren't the best to drive, especially since this game is primarily done on a keyboard. Now the story. The real thing we need to know before getting into the movie. So just very quickly, the game follows Jack Carver. This is the character you play. He's ex-Special Forces and now he works as a boatman, taking people out to wherever they want to go on a boat. His latest customer is a female journalist named Valerie. They go out on their excursion only for the boat to be attacked after she goes off on her own on a jet ski. Jack narrowly escapes the boat as it's being blown up and finds his way onto the island, finding a PDA which he is then contacted through by a man named Harlan Doyle. So Doyle on the other end, this PDA, is the driving force for the player in giving him his objectives and what to do and where to go. The other driving force being looking for Valerie. But your main enemies in this game are a group of mercenaries hired to protect what's on the island. As the game progresses, you find out the mercenaries were here to protect a research facility led by a man named Dr. Krieger. Here they are making enhanced beings, testing on monkeys and then humans in attempts to create a super soldier. What they're using to create these beings is referred to as the mutagen, and what they make, the trigen. Now, the trigen appear to be almost like alien creatures. Some of them were these giant hulking beasts with rockets, then you got these little ones that kind of jump around and have these weird little claws, and then there's other ones that are more human-like, but they still look like a totally different creature, and they can turn invisible. This adds on a new enemy besides the mercenaries that will target the mercenaries as well as the player. Essentially, Jack Carver is an 80s action hero, a one-man army. Sure, he's got the guy in the PDA telling him what to do, but he's not in the fight with him. Which is a fitting way to describe the story of this game. It's not exactly all that great, the writing is nothing special, and the voice acting is pretty, I guess silly, goofy. But really, that adds to the fun, and all it needs to do is set up the action. When you eventually do find Valerie, she reveals that she's actually a CIA agent.
I'm a secret agent.
Doyle is also an agent working as an inside man to help infiltrate the facility to shut down what's going on. Eventually getting to Dr. Krieger and defeating him, you find out that Doyle was actually hoping to take over the operations himself. In this process, it's believed that Jack and Valerie are infected with the mutagen. But they got their way out. They're gonna get Doyle, take him out, and then blow up the island with the nuke that's on there that was placed as a failsafe if things went wrong and they had to destroy all evidence. So of course, Jack makes it out with Valerie and they ride off on a helicopter after killing Doyle and blowing up the island. So all really works out. It's a simple game, but here's the thing. I feel like it's not exactly the type of thing you make a movie out of. Maybe the newer Far Cry's be able to pull off a movie or even some miniseries, but this one didn't exactly have that meat in there outside of just being an action piece. So Far Cry, I'd say, is a pretty great game. Frustrating, definitely, but I had a lot of fun with it, even after getting pissed off with so many deaths. It's a fun game if you're into these types of shooters, because I came off Stalker that also had similar, like, enhanced AI, open world, more, like, tactical-type gunplay, where you actually have to plan what you're doing rather than just run in, shooting up everything, which you can do that, and that actually is a strategy I use a lot of the time. I think it's a title worth checking out whether you missed it or you just want to go back and replay it to see if you still like it. So as a video game, this was a pretty good starting point, but as an inspiration for a movie, I'm not so sure. Because there's some weird bits about this movie's existence, and we're about to get right into that. So I have been tasked with a mission to go and hunt down all the reasons the Far Cry movie is a poor adaptation of the video game.
Oh, damn. Well, I'm here at least. Now to just find my targets. Everything wrong with the Far Cry movie. Looks like my first guy over there.
He started with a gun. Even Jack got a pistol in the beginning.
Maybe I should have gone the other way. Well, I'm not left-handed. So the first thing wrong with the Far Cry movie is...
So yes, the first big problem with the Far Cry movie is that he was directed by Uwe Boll. I'm probably gonna say that wrong a few times. Mr. Boll is kind of known as the worst director. I think that's a little unfair because I feel like I've definitely seen worse movies, but his are just the most prolific because of how big they were for some reason. He had a lot of big box office failures that were all video game adaptations, weirdly enough. He had In the Name of the King, Alone in the Dark, Blood Rain, Postal, one of my favorites, and probably most notably for worst movie ever, House of the Dead. Now, I'm not gonna lie, I like his movies, even if they are kind of bad. He had some pretty good ones that came out after his theatrical run, but that's not what we're talking about. Far Cry, however, is kind of a standout in the sense that it wasn't as big as the other ones. Most people don't even know that there is a Far Cry movie. Weirdly enough, he supposedly got the rights to even make the movie before the game came out. It didn't come out for a few years after it released, but I guess that was to see if they could bank off the game's success.
Hopefully these guys have some good stuff in here for me to take. And say what you want about Uwe Boll. He's not the only reason making this video game into a movie was a mistake. And that is...
So besides getting the wrong director on board, they also just chose a game that didn't exactly have a great story to begin with. Now the game itself isn't really bad, but it's not really one you'd base a movie out of. And if they're not going to deliver the same level of action as the game, it's not going to be that great as an adaptation. But anyways, on with the story. The movie begins with a pretty cool horror sequence. It's kind of like a slasher movie where they're teasing the killer but they don't show you what they look like. If you played the game, you're assuming that it's the Trigen picking off this group of mercenaries. And if you play the game, might notice, the mercenaries actually have some of the same guns from the game, so nice touch. There's also some pretty cool gore effects, something that I wish we saw more of throughout the runtime. Overall, I think it's a pretty cool sequence. It's got enough action going on, even if it's a little silly, it's got some tension going on there. After a title sequence, we're now on a boat with a couple that's being driven by none other than Jack Carver. And a detail that I want to bring up that's not necessarily something bad or wrong with the movie, it's just he's German. And they explain away the fact that he's German in his introduction, which is, it's a little weird that they got a German actor, but what it seems like is that they got German talent for Uwe because he was German or because he was German and wanted German talent. I don't know how that was decided, but it's a common theme I see in a lot of his movies. Jack is played by Til Schweiger. He's got some of his own pull, he had some big roles, and I somehow knew his name before I even saw this movie, so he has some noteworthiness to him anyways. There's not a whole lot of big name talent in this, but there's a few familiar faces. I think he's a good choice because he certainly looks like he could be Jack Carver himself if he was a real person. He's even got the shirt. Like me. And this couple right here in this introductory scene, while I think the scene is pretty good in establishing who the character is, especially going off the background they give him in the game, it's a little awkward. I don't know if they were told to act like this or if they're actually just bad actors, but just check this out.
Promise me whales, George.
You hear that? You go get us some whales, you get us some money back.
It's kind of funny, but it's like, is it bad on purpose or are they just bad? We then get introduced to our main villain, Dr. Krieger. We saw him a little bit in the beginning sequence, but now we really get to know what's going on. I didn't really mention this guy when I was talking about the video game, but there was actually a character in the game that was supposed to be the leader of the mercenaries. And in the movie, he doesn't exist. Instead, it seems that he was replaced by two different characters. I don't really get why there's two sets of soldiers, mercenaries, but there are, and this is part of the conflict of the movie. It seems that the woman here, Chernov, is Krieger's right hand. The other guy is not really fond of her and their methods. What happened in the beginning was actually an exercise to see how their super soldiers, do they even call them that? I'm gonna call them that. It was a test to see how their super soldiers performed. But what it looked like was they were killing Chernov's men, because all of her guys are in black, whereas the other guy, his mercenaries look like they're all in some sort of green, kind of like the ones in the game. He doesn't like that, and he doesn't want his own guys sacrificed, but she seems to not even care about her own people. This is something that's going to come up again later. We're then introduced to our other main character, Valerie, which for some reason, they changed her last name from the video game to the movie. I don't know why, it doesn't really matter. My only gripe with the actress for Valerie is that they didn't try to dress her up much like her in-game counterpart. A little disappointing, but hey, Michael Perret's here, and this is as much as we're gonna see him. But he is actually in a lot of Uwe's movies, so yeah. So she's a reporter, and she's trying to get the inside scoop on what's going on this island, that it turns out that one of the mercenaries on there is her uncle that she's been in contact with. But he gets caught. After all these introductions, we return to the lab on the island. We get to see what these super soldiers look like, and they're no Trigen. They're just big gray dudes, and I'm just saying they're big gray dudes because I think they've just purposely got the tallest guys they could so they'd be more intimidating. I mean, yeah, he's freaky looking, but he's not like this hulking monster that I was hoping for. I would have even taken just CG models based off the games, even if they just ripped them straight from the game and threw them in the movie. I would have liked that a little more than just pale dudes. They're making them for the military, but it's a on-the-down-low sort of operation where if it doesn't work out, they're just gonna say, hey, this doesn't exist, we had nothing to do with it, get rid of it. The results are looking good, except they can't really take orders, and that's the biggest problem with them, because otherwise, they're just gonna kill anybody and everybody.
You're making brainless monsters!
Army guy's upset, and so he storms out saying this is it, but Dr. Krieger is not one to quit. So his next experiment is going to be with Max, Valerie's uncle. Back to Jack, we meet his boss. They're trying to establish him like he's some drunk loser and that he's just doing this because it's the only thing he can do, but I mean, guy's gotta live, you know? They're trying to get him up because his next customer's on the way, and that customer is Valerie. Her plan is to use Jack to get to the island so she can meet up with her uncle and get the story she wants. They eventually get him up with a ding of the bell, and Valerie's on board. There's some conversation between them. It's kind of boring, so I'm not really going to go over it much. The important part being is that she seems to know him in some way. She tries bringing up her uncle Max as a way to try to gain Jack's trust into convincing him to take her to the island that he already had said is off limits. Apparently, Jack and Max were in the special forces together.
That money will buy you exactly a ride to the island and back, that's it.
So we're well over 20 minutes, about half an hour into the movie, which is a third of the movie's runtime, and we're just barely getting to where the game starts. Now the way the game started was that the boat got attacked as they were reaching the island. It's more or less like the game, except the fact that Valerie doesn't take a jet ski away off on the boat.
So at a certain point in the movie, you noticed several things wrong, at least from a visual standpoint. And I'm just gonna go ahead, take them all out at the same time, and then we'll talk them through, let it sort itself out. Yeah, getting pretty good at this. Oh!
Yep, that's the next big point. I think we've seen enough of the movie to say, this is not a tropical chain of islands. We're nowhere near the Pacific. Well, maybe we are, just not the part with all the palm trees. The movie was shot in Canada, so the setting's not quite right, and that is upsetting. And that's the next thing I was disappointed with. There's no Trigen. There's none of these weird alien-looking things. They could have at least just gotten models from the game and put them in. I would have taken that, even if it looked goofy. And yeah, I'm kind of bringing these points up back to back right here because everything kind of falls apart once we're at the island with Jack. I know I praised him a little for that opening scene, but there's not enough of the iconic guns. When Jack does get a handgun, it's not a Deagle. It's just some Glock. And I'm pretty sure the one he has on the cover is an Airsoft. So they make it to the island at the meeting spot that was decided by Max, but he's not there. So Valerie's trying to find him, and Jack's just waiting on the boat. In the process, they take her away, and they blow up Jack's boat. But he makes it away, just like the game. And I'm disappointed by their choice of rocket launcher for this. They used an RPG, not the four-round thing from the game. Come on. Fun fact, that rocket launcher that was pretty much introduced to us during the movie Commando, well, it didn't actually fire rockets. It essentially was a long-range flamethrower shooting incendiary rounds instead of explosive ones.
I lied.
Jack gets in a fight. He's on his way to give Valerie just so he can take her and get away from this place. He manages to give Valerie and steal one of the mercenaries' jeeps, and he drives off. This kicks off a pretty fun chase sequence, honestly. So Valerie's handcuffed, but Jack, he just so happens to come prepared for just the situation. He keeps the handcuff key in his pocket at all times. So while he's driving, she's having to handle all the weapons in the back to try to get rid of the guys on their tail. There's a kind of funny bit where she just throws a grenade without pulling the pin and he has to explain why that's useless. And then that sends off to her screwing up kind of badly.
Is that too hard?
Yeah.
At least it does a little something for him. She eventually gets this grapple gun and she doesn't know what to do with it and she ends up shooting it out the roof of the Jeep. And this also just so happens to catch a helicopter, which eventually in their drive when they're going to a cliff, gets lifted off by the helicopter. This actually helps give them a good chance to escape as they just fall into the water and swim away. We get a stupid setup for a love scene. We don't see anything, there's no nudity, but you know what it's going for. There's no hint of romance in the game. Like, yeah, there's a bit where she gets in her underwear and takes a shower in a waterfall, but even then, that doesn't even lead to anything. And is Jack even watching her in that scene? I can't even remember. I don't know, it's just one of those dumb things that action movies like to add for some reason. The reason I say for some reason, they didn't even do it for nudity in this one. They get up the next morning and go on a casual stroll. They're not acting like they're in any danger or like they're being hunted at all. He asks about his performance, and he's rated more or less how the movie was.
A two.
What?
They eventually hear a truck approaching and they plan their next move. Valerie gets in the middle of the road and plays distraction to get the trucks to stop. Jack comes in to hold the driver hostage so he can get a hold of their uniform so he can sneak into the base in a disguise. It works, but one big problem, Valerie can't blend in. So he hides her away with these barrels that are under a sheet, and this is one of the funniest, like, moments in the movie to me. The way she gets found. They show the guys watching all the security cams, and they just so happen to have a camera pointed directly at these useless barrels. Like, there's nothing happening here. And they just so happen to have a camera right where she hid, and she didn't even hide well.
I need a word with you.
There's a bit here with Chernov and her mercenaries. One of the guys stands up saying, he's like, hey, I'm not getting paid here just so you can kill me off. Which, she doesn't like that.
You got me messed up, you think I'm gonna let you do that to me? Bitch! See? That easy.
But in all seriousness, all these dudes have guns. There's a whole other group of mercenaries there that don't work for her that already don't like her for the same reason y'all do. Why do y'all still work for her? Why don't y'all kill her and take over? I mean, there's more of y'all than her. There's some guys dropping off supplies. Guess they're the ones here keeping everybody fed. While they're unloading supplies, there's one dude left on the boat and he's just wanting to have his lunch break. So Jack's sneaking up on the guy so he's gonna, you know, choke him out so he can steal the boat. But he ends up choking on his sandwich. So instead he decides, you know what, this guy didn't do anything. He's just dropping off stuff. I'm gonna save him. But instead of doing the Heimlich, he just beats his back to get him to spit it out.
Great heavens, that man is choking!
Don't worry.
I'm on it.
That was a goner! Oh my god, you saved my life! You saved my life!
Well, all's well, but they get caught. They're wondering, who the hell is this guy? And we get a boat chase. It's not the greatest chase in the world, but it's actually shot pretty decently. But also, hey, there's a level in the game just like this, so I'll take it. They get caught, so Jack is now prisoner with Emilio, the food guy. They show they have Valerie, and they do that whole thing where they have them meet face-to-face, like, oh, you're gonna die here, and we have her, you failed. But she's able to give him this little something. She slips him the key with a kiss, and there's a gag here where he's choking on it, and Emilio's just kind of stupid. But eventually he gets it. He's clearly the comic relief character, but I don't really think we needed one. The reason they left him here cuffed was so they could test out their new soldier, Max. So even though he's supposed to be their best one and can actually take orders, it turns out him having the ability to do so actually let him still have some free will, and he does not kill Jack and the food guy. This leads to them releasing a different one to come in and fight Max, as well as kill off Jack. Disappointed in the results, they release another one, but things don't quite work out as they eventually just all break out and all hell breaks loose. You get one of those like superhero type fight scenes where the guys are slamming each other with the super soldiers doing that and Jack is doing backflips around the room for some reason. It's kind of fun to watch, but it is also really stupid. And because all the other super soldiers are out, pretty much everyone's getting killed by everyone. Got super soldiers, mercenaries, they're accidentally killing each other because they suck apparently. And well, that's not going to stay contained for long.
So another thing I didn't really want to mention so early on is just, well, there's another huge issue, and that's just, not everyone's the same. It's just not quite right.
So now we've gotten far enough into the story for there to be twists and all that, there aren't any. Valerie really is just a journalist. There's no bit where she reveals,
I'm a secret agent.
And there's no character to substitute or replace Doyle, so that element is completely missing. And the whole thing with the mercenaries, there wasn't even at least a bit where Jack is like hunting down the head mercenary and then he takes out the doctor. There's not even anything like that. It's eventually just becomes friends with part of them.
So this next guy here might sound a lot like the last one, but trust me, whole different beast. And it's something that's been bothering me, I'm sure you, throughout the whole runtime of the movie. And it is simply that, well,
and as we're in the final act of the movie, I will finally say this. Jack is nothing special. Almost all of the action is carried out by the mercenaries. Yeah, he's the driving force for like how things happen when they happen, but most of it is really these guys fighting each other. If you take Jack out of this probably would have all happened anyways. He's not a badass one-man army like he is in the game. It's just disappointing, like they could have had him do so much more and had him do so much more of the killing. After the Trigen break out, it's all out war with the mercenaries. And the easiest way to look at it, the guys in black versus the guys in green. I guess I somehow didn't really catch this in my first watch because I was a little confused like who knew to fight who, but it's a little obvious and I feel kind of dumb. But the movie itself is kind of dumb, so I don't feel that bad. So not only are the mercenaries fighting each other, they're still having to worry about all the Trigen running around, and they can only kill them with shots to the mouth and eyes. Surprisingly, we got some good marksmen here, but most of them can't hit the things. There's some fun bits with the way the Trigen fight and kill everyone, and it's a little disappointing to watch them die. We get a few more of those cool action and gore effects shots, but I just wish there was more of them. Because, I mean, the chase sequence in the Jeep was pretty cool, but then the one on the boat was kind of, yeah, it's alright looking. There should have just been more of this, like, crazy stuff going on. As Jack's running around fighting his own fights, he eventually runs into some of the mercenaries, but luckily he doesn't run into Chernoff. He pretty much becomes friends with the mercenaries that try to give him an out, but he's like, no, I gotta get Valerie and then get her out of here. I could have bought their romance more, honestly, if it was a thing that they already knew each other through Max, but it seems like he just kind of heard about her, if anything. It just makes the romance more stupid, and I just hate when action movies add that for no reason. In all the chaos, Krieger has been trying to escape with Chernoff, holding on to Valerie as insurance. He knows Jack would ruin things, and she was already trying to spill the beans on everything going on the island, so it makes sense why they keep her around, but at the same time, why don't they just already kill her? Jack eventually catches up, but he can't quite take out everyone, and this is where I'm just disappointed with him. It's like, he's not a one-man army, he couldn't even save Valerie. Max has to step in and save the day, which he does. And finally, someone killed that bitch. But sadly, he died in the process of taking down Chernoff and the other mercenaries. Jack and Valerie make it out with the food guy on a boat, and they say goodbye to Dr. Krieger, who is left to be killed by his own experiments. All is well, Jack is continuing his business with Emilio as his cook, and he's still with Valerie apparently. And his first customer since then is, well, our same lovely couple from the beginning.
So I wouldn't be surprised if you thought my journey was over, but there's one last thing I need to take care of before we officially leave. So I know it's well far behind us, but there's one glaring issue that didn't really bother me until I found it out.
The budget was supposedly $30 million, and it does not show. There's all these locations I talked about from the game that didn't quite make it to the movie, and it's like, you couldn't have shot, like, in Hawaii or something? I don't know. Something more tropical. You could have had some more cool-looking guns to match the aesthetic of the game, you could have maybe gotten some more big names in the movie to give yourselves more credit, and you could have done a lot more action, like more gore, more big, fiery explosions, just something more eye-catching. There's some good CG in here, some good bits of action here, so
Clearly they could pull it off, but I can't quite see where all that money went. Some movies have an incredibly high budget for some of the actors they get, but I can't imagine these guys got paid that much to make up a majority of that budget. It's just kind of disappointing. But as I said, as one of my first big points, it wasn't that great of a story to begin with. It essentially was doomed to fail as a movie. I mean, yeah, there's other movies where it's a pretty big focus on the action, so there was a chance, just wasn't given to the right hands. I still kind of like the movie just as a random direct-to-video action movie, but knowing how much it cost, it doesn't quite feel like it belongs in that same realm. It's a fun action movie, it gets half the things right about Far Cry, but it gets the other half just wrong that you can't really tell that's what it was supposed to be. So if you just want a quick and easy action movie, this is actually kind of worth the pickup. I had fun with it. I had fun making fun of it. That's just kind of what these movies are sometimes. You just want an easy watch, or you're just in the mood for some dumb action. I know I am a lot of the time.
The day when you rated me 2 out of 10, you were joking, right? Two points. She wouldn't see me if it was only 2 points.
So if you enjoyed what you saw, leave a like, subscribe, and share the video. And feel free to share any thoughts you had in the comments below. If you want to see me try different foods and rate them, check out Shyboy616 Eats. And if you're more in the mood for watching video games than hearing someone talk about the movie adaptation of one, then check out Shyboy616 Plays. I am Shyboy616, and I will see you next time.